Hello and welcome to the final edition of Baker Donelson's 2015 Higher Education Webinar Series. We're glad you could join us today. My name is Dan Cohen and I'm the chair of Baker Donelson's Higher Education team. Baker Donelson is an Am Law 100 law firm with over 650 attorneys and 19 offices. Among other practices, we have a team of experienced attorneys focusing on serving the legal needs of educational institutions across a broad spectrum of legal matters, including intellectual property and licensing, privacy and information security, healthcare and issues affecting medical academic programs, construction and public finance, labor and employment, and other unique issues affecting colleges like student discipline, sexual misconduct, and intercollegiate athletics. Each month throughout 2015, our higher education attorneys hosted free webinars addressing timely topics across the spectrum. Feel free to contact a member of our higher education team if you have any questions about our past programs, all of which are available online on Baker Donelson's higher education website, or feel free to reach out to us if you have questions about other legal matters. Also, we are excited about starting our new higher education webinar series in early 2016. So if you have a topic that you would like for us to cover in 2016, please either use the comment buttons that are available during your webinar, or afterwards you will receive a survey asking for your input about today's webinar, and on that survey you can also feel free to let us know what webinar topics might interest you for 2016. Today, Paula Estrada de Martin will be talking about recent shifts in the patent law landscape. Paula is a life sciences and biotechnology patent attorney in the firm's New Orleans office. She received her PhD in cell biology from Yale University and was a postdoctoral fellow at Cornell's Weill Medical College. She's a member of the intellectual property group and the global business team here at the firm. She focuses her practice on U.S. and foreign patent prosecution for life science, biotechnology, and plant fields, patent interferences, and patent portfolio management for university and research institutions involved in life sciences and plant spaces. With that, I will turn it over to Paula. Thanks.
Hi, thanks, Dan. Thanks for the introduction, and thanks for all taking the time to be here today. What I would suggest that you guys, or ask that you guys could do, is at the end of the presentation, go ahead and email me your questions. So hold on to them, and I will try to address them as we go through the topics. So as a quick review, a patent is a set of exclusive rights that are granted by the government by way of the USPTO, for example, here in the US. They're granted to an inventor for a fixed period of time in exchange for public disclosure of that invention. A patent is a limited property right effective only within the jurisdiction of which the patent application is filed. So for example, if an application is filed here in the U.S., jurisdiction would be specifically within the U.S. and its territories, etc. If you file in Japan, your jurisdiction would be there, obviously, in Japan. There are three types of patents that are typically granted here in the U.S., the first being the one that most are probably most familiar with. That first one is a utility patent, which protects a useful device or a method, for example, how something works or how it's used. It's also useful for protecting functional structural features, for example, of a device, of a composition, and the like. The term for utility patent is 20 years from the date of filing. However, there are some applications that if they were filed prior to June 8, 1995, there's a different patent term that is associated with those particular applications that eventually issue to a patent. There are not many of those around here in the U.S. There's about 120-some left, so I don't think most of you are in that camp. But if you are, that term for a patent for that time frame would be 17 years from the grant or 20 years from filing, whichever is longer. A second type of patent that's issued here in the U.S. is a design patent. This typically protects the ornamental slash, you know, non-functional appearance of an article, for example, how something looks. Design patents have a shorter term. For a design patent, it's 15 years from the issuance if it was filed before on or after May 13, 2015. if the application for a design patent was filed prior to May 13, 2015, then the patent term is 14 years. The third type of patent that the U.S. grants is a plant patent. A plant patent protects certain types of asexually reproduced plant varieties. It has the same term as that of utility patents, and they're typically not as common because most people tend to pursue utility protection for plants, but it's possible that you could pursue protection under both of these regimes. In order for a patent to be granted, the application must be directed to patentable subject matter under Section 101 of the patent law. This will be discussed in much more detail in the next few slides. In addition, excuse me, I'm sorry, I'm fighting a cold here. In addition, for a patent to be granted, it must satisfy also the utility requirement. For example, you must show that the invention is useful. In addition to these requirements, for a patent to be granted, it must be shown that the subject matter is novel. For example, no single disclosure describes the claims of the invention. There's no other prior art out there that anticipates it. It also must be non-obvious. So this is measured according to a standard that we refer to as the person of ordinary skill in the art. And what happens in this particular test is the examiner will take art that's out there, and you have to be able, as the applicant, to show that your invention is non-obvious when presented with 1, 2, 3, even 6 references that are out in the prior art. And finally, in order for a patent to be issued, the subject matter that's described in the application has to be sufficiently enabled and described. So what is patentable subject matter? In the last few years, this particular area of law has changed quite a bit, and there's been many cases have come down, three main ones from the Supreme Court, and then various cases that have been coming down from the Federal Circuit as well as throughout the district courts. Today we're going to be focusing on the case law that's come down from the Supreme Court. And first, to give you a little background, we're going to look at what exactly the statute specifies as is considered patentable subject matter. According to the patent laws, patentable subject matter is any new and useful process. For example, series of acts that are performed upon subject matter to be transformed and reduced to a different state or thing. It also corresponds, this process prong, to methods. So in the life sciences space, we're looking at, for example, methods of treatment, methods of doing something, methods of determining a certain state. Secondly, under Section 101, patentable subject matter also can be a machine. And this is a little more concrete, the concrete thing according to Section 101, that consists of various parts or certain devices or even a combination of devices. Patentable subject matter also can be an article of manufacture. So for example, producing articles from raw or prepared materials by giving these materials new forms, new qualities, new properties, or combinations of these, whether you do it by hand, labor, or you invoke some sort of machinery. Another category of patentable subject matter is the composition of matter claims. This is probably what most of you are familiar with also. These are substance compositions. So if you're looking at, for example, in the life science space, which a lot of universities tend to delve in, you're looking at chemical or biological compounds. In addition, I highlight an underline under here, improvements thereof. And what I mean by this is improvements of any of these different categories of patentable subject matter can also be deemed patentable. So if you have an improvement of any one of these, a composition, a manufacturer, a process, a method, that in theory also could be deemed patentable subject matter. Now recently, there's been a lot of talk of that subject matter which is not considered patentable subject matter, but first let me give you the first the broader categories of these judicial exceptions. And what I mean by judicial exceptions means that these are made by case law as to what the court, particularly the Supreme Court, has found to be patentable or not patentable. And those include here, as I have listed, natural phenomena, which encompasses natural occurring products, in addition to mathematical expression and algorithms. This could be particularly important, especially when you're looking in the bioinformatics space. Another judicial exception are abstract ideas, in addition to laws of nature. If you notice here, I have three specific categories that are bolded, and that's because these are the three topics of judicial exceptions that were the subject of three Supreme Court decisions that have come down in the recent years. One of the most recent cases that was impacting, I would say, the life sciences in particular, and that has impacted determining what is considered patentable subject matter, is the Association for Molecular Pathology versus Myriad, also known as the Myriad case, or more commonly for those folks not in the in the life science space, but referred to as kind of the BRCA1, BRCA2 gene case that deals with the cancer gene cases. So here, previously, you were able to isolate genomic DNA compositions, and those particular isolated compositions were deemed to be patentable subject matter. However, since this case has come down, this has shifted how the patent office, based on the decision that came down from the Supreme Court, of what's considered patentable subject matter. In the Myriad case, this dealt with genetic tests that was identified that identified women that were at risk for suffering for breast or ovarian cancer if they expressed, for example, the BRCA1 and or the BRCA2 genes. In particular, the two test claims that were issued in this case were, one, composition claims that were directed to isolate DNA molecules, so genomic DNA that was isolated from patients that were expressing the BRCA1 and or BRCA2 genes. And the second type of claim that was at issue in this particular Supreme Court case were those composition claims that were directed to cDNA or complementary DNA. In the Myriad case, the court found that isolating DNA molecules, for example, the genomic DNA, was not sufficient to confer patent eligibility. Basically found that a naturally occurring DNA segment is a product of nature and not patent eligible. Merely just lifting out the genomic DNA from the subject was not enough. In fact, some language from the case notes that Myriad did not create or alter any of the genetic information encoded in the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes. So because there wasn't anything different of what was found in nature, the court found that this isolated type of DNA was not patentable subject matter. However, they did go on to discuss that cDNA, complementary DNA, is not a product of nature and is patent eligible under Section 101. Interestingly, before I even go on talking about the Mayo Prometheus case, just last month in Australia, the higher court there ruled that the Myriad, which was also a case was brought up there before their high Supreme Court, couldn't patent the isolated BRCA1 gene in Australia. So isolated biological materials that were derived from natural environments are not patentable such matter in Australia. So this is one jurisdiction also to keep note of if different universities are pursuing patent compositions that were directed to these isolated types of DNA sequences, because now with that case that came down in Australia, there could be a shift and there could be a different way you're going to have to pursue claims in those countries. But Australia is the first one that's come down similar along the likes of here in the U.S. So the second case that has impacted the landscape of patent eligibility under Section 101 is Mayo v. Prometheus. In this case, I go into detail here on the slide as to what the invention is, but basically, the claim that was invalidated by the Supreme Court was directed to the method of determining the amount of a drug that is absorbed into a patient's body. And then from that, determining the proper dosage that a drug can be used, or an optimum dosage that is useful for treating an autoimmune disease. So a lot of this is a lot of mental steps and going through a process of determining, you know, a sort of output. And here, what was interesting is that the court found that these medical tests, these diagnostics that were relying on these correlations between the drug dosages and treatment, are not eligible for patent protection. These are just merely steps that the doctor, the clinician, was going through in order to figure out, you know, what exactly was going on in the patient's body. So because it was just a series of steps that one was thinking through, it wasn't enough to be deemed patent eligible subject matter. Here the court reasoned that the natural laws themselves were not to be patented. And again, we're talking about something that's going on actually in the body, looking at these rate of absorptions in relation to the dosing that they received. And because these were natural laws and cannot be patented, they cannot be patented even in connection with processes that involve well understood routine conventional activity. And what the court was getting at here is basically the doctors have been doing this for a long time. Physicians were in the lab measuring these types of concentrations in the patients, in the patients, and doing a type of analysis, type of step in the mind that has been done for years. So here, nothing new was being introduced into these diagnostic methods. So accordingly, the court found here that the claims in Prometheus were not patent eligible subject matter. Now, the next line of cases and the most recent of the 101 subject matter cases that have come down from the Supreme Court is Alice Core versus CLS Bank. Now, Alice is different from Mayo and Myriad in that the patent technology at issue was a computer-implemented business method rather than a life sciences technology, whether it be a method of diagnosing or composition of matter. Here in Alice, the court reviewed the subject matter eligibility of processes, similar to what the court was reviewing in Mayo. Only here, the invention was directed to a method for exchanging financial obligations. In addition, claims at issue that were assessed were a computer used to perform the method, and finally, software designed to cause the computer to perform the method. Here, the court unanimously ruled that this technology was not patent eligible since it was simply an abstract idea that was implemented using a generic computer system and software. And I highlight the term abstract idea because now, after this case, examiners have been going haywire in issuing rejections in both the life sciences space and also in computer implemented methods as to what is patentable subject matter. So this is common rhetoric we're seeing at the prosecution stage of many applications. And it's also a common argument that the courts are using to strike down inventions in both the predictable and unpredictable arts. So that being kind of, for example, life sciences in addition to the computer space. So you might think, okay, we have this case, Alice, that's come down, so really how does that affect the life sciences? Well, as you see here, for example, Alice is touching all areas of patent-eligible subject matter, and again, it reeks into the life sciences. And the reason why I bring this one up is because many portfolios within university settings do have these types of claims if those universities are involved in any sort of life sciences and or medical research. So this is one area that's really impacting universities at quite a high rate. And here we have Alice lurking its head now in what we call the Myriad 2 case. In this particular case, which is quite interesting, the inventions that were involved here were comparisons between what we call wild-type BRCA sequences, which is basically the normal sequence found on a subject, and then comparing them to patients' BRCA sequences. So basically, we're having the normal type of sequence that has no mutations, for example, so no cancer-causing agents, and they're comparing this sequence, for example, to that of patients that are exhibiting cancer. So here we have mutations, whatnot, for example, present in the BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene, or that are that you have the BRCA1 BRCA2 gene. And more globally, how this is applicable is if you're doing any sort of gene comparisons between, you know, say one that's diseased and versus one that's not, this particular case implicates all those types of claims that are out there, whether already granted and or whether are pending in the patent office. Because here, what happened is the Federal Circuit is using the case that came down from the High Court in Alice and is applying it to biotechnology cases and is striking down now, for example, in this case, Myriad's method of screening claims. So here now we're looking at claims where you're comparing one sequence to another, and based on Alice's rubric of abstract ideas, for example, implicating thought processes that are going on within the mind of the researcher or the mind of the physician or the mind of the provider, looking at just the sequences and in their head doing a comparison between the two and stopping at that point without doing anything much more, the court, Federal Circuit, applied that methodology and said that in the case for Myriad, it was patent ineligible because it's recited abstract ideas. So here, to get into more of the meat of these claims, the Federal Circuit said that the claims are directed to this abstract mental process of comparing and analyzing two gene sequences. And by requiring merely this comparison between a wild type and the patient and noting any differences is not enough. There's nothing going on. And interestingly, even though the claims themselves incorporated certain types of what we call hybridization probes and PCR primers to detect the BRCA genes of interest, so your target gene, whatever that may be, here in Myriad, it was the BRCA gene, because they were using well-understood routine and conventional methods and routine techniques, it wasn't enough to get them over that one-on-one hurdle. So here the court, the Federal Circuit, found that you couldn't transfer the abstract ideas recited in the comparison step into patent eligible such a matter under 101 by just merely incorporating some sort of methodology that's routine in the laboratories. So here, because we can't pass, we can't get over this section 101, this first basic threshold issue, whether or not something's even patentable, the cases won't even go beyond that. There won't be any additional analysis under 102, which is anticipation, or 103 under obviousness. So if you're in, for example, in the patent office and you're undergoing examination of your application for whatever subject matter it is you're pursuing, if you can't get beyond this 101 test, this very first threshold issue, you're not going to go anywhere further with the examiner. And this is what we're finding, actually, in many cases for many of our university clients, especially in the life sciences. And in talking to colleagues that are in the computer space, it's the same thing that they're encountering as well. So with all these cases that have been come down from the Supreme Court, of course, this is putting the patent office in a state of flux and constantly having to reassess, okay, what guidelines, how are their examiners going to be assessing applications that are coming through in front of their desks. So in about a year ago, the USPTO issued what is called its interim guidance and tried to give some guidelines as to how claims would be examined there in the patent office for patent eligible subject matter under section 101. And they did a pretty good job in laying out the test and laying out what they will be looking at. And what the PTO did in taking into account both the Myriad Prometheus case and Alice is it tried to lay out a framework that's applicable to laws of products of nature as well as abstract ideas. And their analysis is based on asking these two questions. The first is asking whether or not the claim is directed to any judicial exception, which, as we talked about earlier, are those case law made designations such as natural phenomena, such as the algorithms, et cetera, those exceptions we spoke about earlier. And then whether or not and if it is directed to a judicial exception, then whether or not the claim recites significantly more than that exception. And significantly more is what the guidance goes into describing, helping the applicant get a better understanding, you know, what the examiner is looking for, what the patentist is looking for in order to get over this 101 hurdle. So for example, a product in nature can now be patentable with such matter based on exhibiting markedly different characteristics. And I have that in quotes because the guidelines go into detail as to what these characteristics could be. So they give examples in four different types of categories, pretty broad, and it gives some guidance as to, you know, what we're going to be able to hang our hat in terms of what's patentable, kind of some of the key language and some of the key terms. One of them is looking at what characteristics pertain to in terms of the biological or pharmacological functions or activities. In other words, whether or not these compositions are inhibitory, are they non-inhibitory, how are they different than what's found in nature? And they're able to lay out this type of characteristic or this type of activity as to be something to be on the lookout for. And if your product exhibits this type of characteristic, then that's something we can point the examiner to if it's in your specification and draft claims that incorporate these features. Now, the caveat is if you're starting from scratch, this is pretty helpful and easy to do, just making sure you're describing your product, your invention, as best as possible. And we'll go into this a little bit more in the subsequent slide. However, the trick is going to be whether or not enough of this type of language, this type of description of these characteristics is present in the specification if the application has already been filed prior to the issuance of these three cases from the Supreme Court. Another example that the USPTO gives guidance on is looking at the chemical and physical properties of this product in nature. For example, is it more alkaline than what's found in nature? Is it more basic? Are there other characteristics? For example, is it more ductile? Does it have a higher melting point? So these are characteristics you want to definitely describe more in detail in your application, and hopefully if an application has already been filed, some of that is already in there, for example, as described in the example section of the application. Furthermore, the Patent Office also looked to describing products of nature in terms of a phenotype, including like functional and structural characteristics. So the shape of it, the size of it, color, anything that goes on to some outward appearance of your product of nature, in addition to maybe even the behavior of the organism. And then finally, the Patent Office also points us to look at these types of characteristics in terms of chemical, genetic, or physical structure and form. So are there plasmids present? Is the genetic makeup or the genotype of the cell organism different than what's found in nature? For example, has a tag been incorporated? Have other sites been introduced that makes it much more malleable to insertion of certain types of fluorescence tags or something like that? So it's whatever types of characteristics that the inventor had, what he created, what he did, that is really going to have an impact on how to get over this 101 barrier now. Recently, in July of 2015, the USPTO updated its guidance with additional narrative as to how ALICE, for example, has been applied in various Federal Circuit decisions. The analysis has basically still remained the same. You still have to ask whether the invention is directed to a judicial exception. And then finally, if it is, are there elements that amount to significantly more than the exception? So the framework is still the same, but the guidance that was issued here in July just gives further examples and further description as to how the PTO is looking at the threshold issue patentable subject matter at this point. However, the PTO notes that 101 assessments, again, what's patentable subject matter, will be evolving as more cases are decided, for example, from the Federal Circuit, and more clarity as well as direction is provided. In addition, if there are other cases that end up going to the Supreme Court, hopefully that will also give us more guidance. And again, the USPTO will be reassessing its guidelines and be incorporating whatever new information and more clarity is provided, if any, in these cases as we see them come down. So how do we begin to address these changes in 101? You know, what practical tips can you focus on from this point forward? Well, as I said earlier, in terms of applications that are already pending before the PTO, that's a little more challenging. It depends on what's already disclosed in the application, and hopefully there's enough substance there that you can go through the specification and find some of these magical words, some of this magical description that will help you convince the patent examiner, for example, that you have indeed patentable subject matter that's being claimed. You might have to go in and make some claim amendments based on either rejections you're getting from the examiner, or as a preemptive strike file, for example, a preliminary amendment to try to address some of these issues that the examiner is going to flag. So first, one tip that we've been telling folks, and this is more now along the lines if you're filing an application from scratch, a new application, so that you're able to keep all this in mind while the application is prepared, is to describe as many specific variants of, for example, your sequences as you can in the specification. So if you're looking to incorporate, or you've identified some DNA sequences or amino acid sequences that are in the inventor's mind, you know, patentable because they've done something to them or they've optimized them somehow, make sure that this is well described in the application. Describe as much as possible in there of what the inventor has done. And the key is going to be, or the balance is going to be, the trick is the claim sequences are broad enough to encompass your variants of your precise sequence. So again, if you're looking at nucleic acid sequences or amino acid sequences, it's incorporated enough variation in there that you cover any sort of, again, variants, any changes, any differences that you would find in nature, and be able to point them out. Part of it may be finding consensus sequences. Maybe it might be pointing out regions that are shared among a different, say protein variants within your application. Maybe you can claim those sequences in terms of having one amino acid sequence, you know, like say a residue present as an alanine, alanine, lysine, and maybe some sort of X where X could be something else, and then having a couple other amino acids thereafter. So it's going to be taking some more time going into this and finding similarities to be able to broaden yourself out and to give yourself a little bit of wiggle room. And again, if you're talking about DNA sequences, you know, were they coded and optimized? Were they degenerate? Were they mutagenized in any way? If it's cDNA, make sure specify that it's cDNA because that's what the court found in Myriad, for example, to be patentable subject matter. If you're looking at primers and probes, describe them in ways that maybe those primers and probes, you know, span certain exon lengths, or maybe they contain some sort of label, or maybe you've the inventors have some manipulated in one way or another that is different than what's found in nature. When it comes to, again, say we're looking at recombinant molecules, such as maybe recombinant proteins, say antibodies, these are going to have, you know, different glycosylation profiles that you would see in compared to what you would see in nature. So again, it's going to be emphasizing what the inventor has done, what the inventor has identified, and from there, just focus in on what those differences are, because we're going to have to probably paint a little roadmap for the examiner to show them what the differences are if the examiner doesn't see it right away. And it's a good chance the examiner won't see it, only because the examiner, for the most part, won't read the specifications in great detail. They have, you know, quite an extensive docket that they're in charge, you know, that they're in charge of, that they have to review and examine. So when they review an application, they're probably going to be focusing quickly on the abstract, probably quickly on your claims. They're going to do target search searches for different types of buzzwords, and that's about it. So they're probably not going to spend as much time as the applicant in terms of them preparing their application that they filed in the patent office. And here, again, on the slide, which kind of summarizes what we've been talking about, it's going to be really up to the applicant, if they're filing the application, to describe as best as possible, as much as possible, these markedly different characteristics. And by incorporating as much as possible in the application, you set yourself better in a better place for being able to convince the examiner that you indeed are dealing with patentable subject matter. And again, I can't emphasize enough that the key aspect to convincing this examiner as to patentability of your product of nature, or what would be considered a product of nature, is to describe as best as possible what you did, what the inventor did to make that nucleic acid, that particular composition, that protein, that organism, different from what is found in nature. Again, it's going to be all about describing, describing, describing. Now, practice tips for overcoming 101 hurdles with respect to diagnostic and method claims. For example, these are the types of claims that were being invalidated both in Prometheus as well as the Myriad II case that came out of the Federal Circuit this last December. So in this type of claim drafting, or in this type of claim set, one of the things we're seeing and one of the things that we're doing is to include as many varying levels of transformative steps as possible. And what we mean by transformative is, what are we doing that makes something different, that we're changing something from one to another? For example, transformative steps can deal with how the sample is treated as part of the diagnostic test. So what are you doing to the blood sample? But be careful, though, as they've been in some of the cases saying, doing something that's routine, something that's conventional, is not going to be enough. So it's got to be something something more than what's routine that's going to get us over this hurdle. So if you've identified, for example, a novel antibody or some sort of detector or some sort of binding agent, you might be able to incorporate that into your diagnostic or method claim. The other is, in terms of transformative steps, is dealing with how the subject themselves is treated on the diagnostic test. So say, for example, you have a method of determining, say in the Prometheus case, where they were determining that X amount of dosing affects, how much of the drug is absorbed in the body. All right, so what? So you have this data, you have this information, what do you do with it? So if, for example, it falls below a certain level, then what would you want to do to the patient? Maybe give them something else, or maybe give them a boost, or maybe give them less, to be more responsive. So depending whatever your methodology is, whatever your diagnostic is, you'll want to do something to the patient to try to get you over that 101 hurdle. As I mentioned earlier with talking about how the sample is treated, perhaps if you're looking at detecting new types of markers or S&Ps, or if you're using like new types of detection reagent, incorporate that into how the sample is treated, for example. But just again, be aware that there is a fine line between what the examiner is going to deem something that's considered routine and conventional. Alternatively, if you're looking at diagnostic and method type claims, consider incorporating method of treatment claims in the application as drafted. And if you have an application that's already pending, look through the application and see if something was done or there's some sort of language that would support these method of treatment claims. These method of treatment claims can be pursued here in the U.S., but just keep in mind that in jurisdictions, for example, like in Europe, you can't necessarily use method of treatment claims, but you can use a different type of format that our European agents use to transform these method of treatment claims into claims that are acceptable subject matter there in that jurisdiction. So it's just a matter of tweaking the type of claim that you're using. In addition, consider incorporating kit claims if you haven't done so or not in the habit of doing so. And these kit claims are basically products or compositions. So you think about a package that incorporates, say, some of these hybridization probes, some of these PCR primers, something along those lines that incorporates a product for doing something. So you're looking at, say, different types of hybridization probes that are useful for detecting the presence of a certain gene. Incorporate those with that type of methodology, and you have a better chance of actually getting over that 101 hurdle. That's something that we found successful. I found that the examiner tends to like that, but you have to be careful with how you type, how you draft the claims so that they're not too overly broad or too general. Now with device claims, I threw this slide in talking to some of my colleagues here that are in, for example, in the device space as well as in the computer space, and kind of using this as an example of some of the hurdles that they're encountering, what they're doing to get over the types of rejections that they're receiving from the examiner. Obviously, there's no claims for perpetual motion machines. I threw that in there because a colleague's client actually was trying to do something like that, and very carefully, my colleague was saying, no, that's not possible. So obviously, we don't want those types of claims in there. But for processes, for example, that are embodied mainly in software, what they've been doing is including claim elements to non-computing machines or devices. So just having it tied up to the computer alone nowadays is not enough, especially in terms of Alice. But being able to couple it to some sort of other a machine of sorts, that seems to be getting them over that first hurdle. Interestingly, in having a discussion with them with respect to, for example, bioinformatics, where you have these algorithms that are being generated to find, for example, say, certain types of genes that are more highly expressed in certain disease states, et cetera, that's getting a little more complicated because, as we discussed earlier, an algorithm is not something that's patentable subject matter, but it is generating all this data that's very, very helpful. So what do you do with it? And one thing the patent bar is concerned about is, you know, you have these, for example, like gene signatures that are being identified that are super useful for helping identify populations of patients. So what do you do with that? So something that we're doing with some of our clients is we're taking, for example, that information, those gene signatures, and having an applicability step attached to it. So we're kind of converting the information that we identify with respect to a certain genetic signature and saying, okay, we have identified, for example, say a population of these people, so what do we do with them? Maybe you start treating them with some sort of a, let's say if you're looking at a person that's more to an autoimmune disease, maybe you start getting them on some sort of regime that helps them delay any sort of onset or that prevents an onset or decreases any sort of symptoms. So depending on what your issue is, you're going to want to start getting this bioinformatic information and see how it can be applied. Like, what will you be doing to a patient population? It narrows the claims, unfortunately, and it doesn't keep it as broad as most people like to have, but at least something that you're able to do and something you're able to grab in terms of claims now at this point. And again, include in that information as much as possible within your application because we don't know how the law is going to change later on. As long as you have hopefully enough, included in your filing initially, that hopefully will be able to be your hook to patentability later on, or maybe language that you can later incorporate into any sort of claim amendments as we see the law changes, because it is right now in a state of flux. As noted here, colleagues of mine were saying it's best if you have claims that incorporate software that actually controls the physical device and or also the operation of the physical device is providing a data or signals to the software that affects the process steps. So again, just coupling it to a computer is not enough, but if something's controlling a device or something, you have software that's doing something, you're getting some sort of tangible output. That seems to be what's getting people over this 101 hurdle. Changing gears a little bit, but not really. Obviously, with all this new jurisprudence that's come down with respect to patent eligible subject matter in Section 101, we've also had a change in the patent law. As most of you know, this came into effect March 16, 2013, referred to as AIA, which is the American Invents Act. And this basically put us in line with the rest of the world where we now became a first-to-file country rather than a first-to-invent country. So this doesn't mean that any application that all applications now are all subject to AIA. What that means is anything that was filed on or after March 16, 2013, you're now examined under the new AIA rules. But anything prior to that is still under the Prior Patent Act. So we still have the first to invent. So you still have, you know, those records in terms of keeping, making sure you have those dates in line so that you're able to show that you first conceived, that you first reduced practice. So for universities that have been in the patent application game for a while, you're going to have sets of applications in both regimes. This is a matter of keeping in line, keeping track of which claims fall under which examination scheme, and also being sure not to make sure you lose your grandfathered status. And this is one of the tricky things that happens with university portfolios is if you have a series of applications that came from, that are stemming from an earlier grandparent or something along those lines, you can lose that grandfathered status in terms of what type of prior art will be you'll be subject to, and the examination rules that you'll be subject to as well. So the reason I bring that up is because as you're drafting out claims for any applications that are filed after AIA was enacted, be sure to incorporate and include claims that are, in other words, like don't mix and match claims. Don't include claims that could have been pursued or is subject matter from, you know, say the pre-AIA timeframe. Stick to what is your current rubric. Otherwise, claims that could have been examined and pursued in the what we call the pre-AIA phase will then all fall under the AIA, and you're not going to have the ability to have basically a hybrid application where you have claims and you know that are being examined under one set of rules and then having another set of claims and a new set of rules. And the reason why I bring this up is because for the prior art, or what we consider you know, if anticipatory types of references change with AIA, and this is key. Here in the U.S., you still get a 12-month grace period for your own disclosures. So if the inventors go out to a conference, they present something, and then, oops, they forgot to tell the tech transfer office or the commercialization folks that, oh, we put a poster out or we gave a presentation, that's okay. You still have 12 months here in the U.S. For your own disclosures. So you're able still to avoid some prior art, for example, prior art that's their own. However, as most folks know, in other countries like, for example, Europe, you're at a risk for loss of foreign rights in absolute novelty countries. So even though you'll have a grace period here in the U.S. for 12 months, in places like Europe, you will not. However, the big change in terms of what's considered prior art comes from art that was published by others. So say, for example, competitors of some of these investigators, some of your PIs. There's no more grace period for those disclosures under AIA, whereas previously, under the old rules, you still had that one-year time frame. So here, they give you the grace period only for disclosures that are made by the inventor. So the key here is, obviously, is to file early and file often. But again, there's a caveat to that. There's a caveat to everything. Although you file early and often, you want to make sure, though, that you still have enough in terms of your written description and enablement so that you're able to pursue your technology under the broadest types of claims you could draft. And the reason why I say that is because you want to make sure that you don't scoop yourself or prevent yourself in terms of the written description requirements later on by not having enough in this early filing. And so this leads me to provisional patent applications. So say your inventor is out, he's giving a talk, and then you find out after the fact that he presented. Okay, fine. We have a year to make sure something's on file. So he's already disclosed. You could take your time and make sure that you have a pretty fleshed out application, making sure that you have a good description in there, good enablement, so that you're able to fully support the claims later on as you file your application, either a non-utility or a PCT international application, or alternatively, if you start filing continuations later on down the line. However, like filing say a provisional application, say for example you find out that your inventor is presenting that day. Well, obviously you're under the gun a little bit. you don't have much time to try to beef up the application as much as possible. So in that instance, you're going to probably be bound to what you disclosed that day. So ideally, give yourself a little bit of time so that you can best describe the invention as much as possible, different embodiments, et cetera, et cetera. But you want to be careful of kind of this, filing too early, or kind of filing under the gun, because you're not going to have enough description. And the reason why this becomes important, as we talked about with all this 101 type of stuff earlier with respect to these markedly different characteristics, you want to make sure that you give your outside counsel, your in-house patent folks, whoever it is that's drafting your applications, enough time to really put together a good application that will not just cover, what we call the picture claim, like your invention just as it's described, but be able to incorporate other embodiments, so you're able to get a little broader protection, because that's really where you start getting more bang for your buck in these applications, is to have a little broader disclosure. So on that note, provisional patent applications are great. They're low cost for the most part, and they're quick. There's no particular formats required, no claims are required. And again, this kind of is your stakeholder. This gives you your earliest application date, the priority date that you're entitled to. It's never examined. If you file it and you don't do anything with it after the 1 year date, no one ever knows about it. It never gets published, et cetera. The only time the provisional application will become accessible to the public is once the non-provisional application, whether in the form of a PCT or a utility application, once that application file gets published at the 18-month date. And as I note here in the very last bullet, you have to file an opportunity utility or PCT application within 1 year of filing the provisional in order to preserve your date. If you decide not to go forward with this particular subject matter because it's too nascent, there's not enough there yet, you feel that maybe there aren't any other competitors out in the market, again, this is an internal decision you guys will have to make, you can let it go. Or you can refile again and, give your inventors a little more time to develop the technology a little bit more. But again, this could jeopardize four rights if an initial disclosure was made, for example, it was presented as a poster, or also if that initial filing was too lean. So you just take the PowerPoint slides, for example, that the inventor uses, or say the poster, you just put that together, slap it together, and there's nothing else to give it any sort of meat or substance. That can hurt you not just here in the U.S., but also abroad. And again, I know it sounds like a broken record here with respect to the sufficiency of disclosure, but it really, really is important that you, as best as possible and as robustly as possible, describe your various embodiments, your invention, for example, if it's directed to nature's products of nature, if it's directed to methodologies, describe it as much as possible with enough information there so that you're able to satisfy that 101 patentability test. But in addition, to be able to show the examiner, once it gets into prosecution, that the inventor did have possession of its invention. It had various examples present. You're able to point to various examples, and you're able to show the examiner that, yeah, you had not just the one picture claim, the main crux of the invention, but also these various embodiments. You have to be able to show the examiner that you're in possession of all of these. In addition to having this written description, you don't want a laundry list of things. You don't want just the new compound you've identified is useful for the treatment of every known cancer known to man. Having these laundry lists now is not enough. You don't want to put that in there. Give some good examples, whether it's in vitro, of how, for example, say your compound is working. And then from there, start crafting maybe some little broader cancer genera. Maybe can't treat every cancer, but maybe could treat various types of epithelial cancers. So that gives you a little more broad coverage as to how you'll be able to apply use of the compound for different types of methodologies. And in doing so, this is one of the key things, especially in life sciences, provide a specification that's enabling. Make sure you teach those skill in the art, so other scientists, other PIs, how one can make and use the invention. Make sure you have enough disclosure there that someone else, another one of equal training, is able to determine how the invention is carried out. So if you're looking at, methods of treatment, let's go back to that same example, include enough protocols and methodology there that will give someone else in the field the sense that, yes, the inventor can use it for treatment of X, Y, and Z. If you're looking at a compound, have synthetic schemes present, not just for the compound of interest, perhaps for a class of compounds that are related. Have these different synthetic schemes, even if you haven't yet synthesized them yet in the lab. Maybe it's going to be something that happens down 6 months down the line, maybe a year down the line. Have enough of that chemistry in place, for example, to show the synthesis of these different variants, because that's always going to be helpful as to when you can claim the earliest priority date to, of when you're able to prove that you had possession of this invention. And then finally, to disclose and not disclose. This is a big question many folks are now asking, especially universities, in terms of AIA that has now been enacted in that we are now a first to file country. So timing obviously depends on the business objectives. Are your PIs going to be presenting at a conference? If so, then yes, definitely you'll want to probably file something. Is there going to be a submission of abstracts for a conference, for abstracts for a paper or for some sort of review? Is it going to be a submission of a grant? All of these are different trigger points that you want to consider whether or not you want to file. In terms of those universities that have different startups spinning off from university-based technologies, will the inventors be presenting to investors? A lot of these investors don't have, will not sign these non-disclosure agreements. So because they won't do so, definitely have a provision on file if something hasn't been filed already. If there's new data that supplements initial filing, consider maybe filing another application. A provisional is only $110. And I know sometimes with budget constraints, that could be a deal breaker, but if you have a little more flexibility in terms of filing applications, then consider filing a follow-on prior to any sort of meeting. And the big one, obviously, is if the PIs, are they going to be submitting a manuscript? Might be early on, but they already have a product that can be used as the basis of an application. So take that manuscript, and we can file that as an application. Timing also depends on whether the space is crowded. Some genetic spaces are super crowded. Some diseases are really crowded. So if there are quite a few investigators that compete against one another in a certain space, it may make sense to file sooner versus later. If it's not so much, if it's in an orphan space, then maybe you have a little bit more leeway. Maybe you have a little more time there. But again, it just depends on what field of invention the investigators are involved in. And again, as I keep saying this, if you're going to be filing a patent application and if you have to disclose, please incorporate and include as robust of a specification as possible given the timing and your circumstances. And again, it does not hurt to file subsequent provisionals. I have had many instances where universities file 1, 2, 3, even 4 provisionals prior to that 1 year date because of the amount of data that's being generated or the amount of additional testing that the investigators have produced with respect to their technologies. If you do not want to disclose, obviously now that we're in this first to file system, there's always the risk of someone else filing first. So again, these are things to take into account, things to consider as you're building your university portfolio. Okay. If there are any questions, I'll take them now. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. Any questions? Don't see anything popping up here in terms of questions, but feel free always to shoot me an email or give me a call if you want to talk offline. More than happy to do so. Again, I've been working with university clients for over 10 years now, and there's definitely certain types of themes I see with respect to the types of issues that universities encounter when building their portfolios or filing their first application. All right, thank you so much.